Hi guys and welcome to Soft Hints. This video is about ThinkPython and Chapter 5, Conditionals and Recursion. If you want to contribute the original author of the book, you can buy it from this link here or pay small amount to him. And let's cover the topic of this chapter. Here you can find some of the most interesting topics in this chapter. And the first topic is floor division and modulus operator. And let's check why we need more ways of division in Python. Let's say that we have a movie which length is 105 minutes and we want to convert this to hours. If we are trying to use the conventional division, we will get a floating point, which is not how we are expressing hours in our everyday. And that's why we need to use some another way. We can use floor division or floor operator, which is expressed with two backslashes. In this case, we will get one. So we are getting an integer number rounded down. So in this case, we have 175. And by using floor operator, we will get one. And this is how the floor operator is working. But we are still not getting the correct hours. We will need to get the remainder from this division. One way to do this is by calculating the hours, which is 1, getting the minutes for these hours, and then extracting from the total minutes. In this case, we will get 45. But there is a shorter way to do this, and this is by using modulus operator. And modulus operator is by using percentage, and we have two operands. So the first one is minutes, which is 105, and the second one is 60. In this case, we will get the same result, which is 45. And this is how you can use floor division and also modulus operator. So conventional division is going to give you float number, which is the exact result of this division. Then if you want to get only the whole part, you can use the floor operator. And finally, if you want to get only the remainder, you can use the modulus operator. And you can use modulus operator in many situations. For example, if you want to check if a given number is odd or even, you can divide on 2 and check do you have remainder or not. And this is showing what is the number. I wanted also to mention that in Python 2, division works in a bit different way, and division is going to return an integer if you have two integers, and floating point in case that both operands are floating points. And this is a typical difference between Python 2 and 3, but Python 2 is not maintained since the beginning of this year, 2020. And let's move to the next topic, which is Boolean expressions. In general, Boolean expression is expression which have two possible outcomes, true and false. And they are typical for some comparisons or some statements when you need to check something. In this case, we will try to see is 5 equal to 5. And as you can see, this is true. If we check the same for 5 and 6, we will get false. And all kinds of comparisons, which you can check here in this table, are going to return similar Boolean expressions or Boolean results. This Boolean, true and false, they are special types in Python, and you can check this by using type and giving the value true or false. You can see that type is bool. And I have a question for you. What is going to be the result of this? You can pause the video and try to answer this question. If you think that we'll get bool, you're wrong, because this is a string and it's not considered as Boolean result. The same is for this. And this is a typical mistake for newbies in Python and programming. This is a reserved keyword for this language. And you need to be sure that you don't have quotes around it or something else. So let's move on next topic, which is logical operators. In this case, logical operators are AND, OR and NOT, and they're really close to English language and how they're working in this language. And let's do a quick demonstration of them. So we have x which is equal to 5, and we have is x greater than 0 and is x less than 10. And can you say what is going to be the answer? In this case we have true, because both of these conditions are true. And let's check if only one of these conditions is true in this case. Again, you can try yourself. In this case we have false, because the first condition is true, but the second is not. And that's why we have true and false, which is equal to false. And this is how logical operators are working. You can see again for OR operator and how it's working. And I prepared a small example in order to get a better view of these logical operators. We have several numbers here and we have two conditions. The first one is by using the previous modulus operator, dividing on Q and checking is this equal to 0 or is the remainder of this division equal to 0, and again the same for division of 3. As you can see here, for the first one we have false, for the second one again we have false, and only for the third number, which is 6, we have true, because the second condition and the third conditions are true. And only for this case logical operator AND returns true, for all other we have false. And let's check how this is going to work for OR operator. For OR operator we have 3 times true, which is for the first statement. And if any of these statements, if any of these numbers divisible Q or 3, we will get true as final outcome, otherwise we will get false. And this is how logical operators are working. And the final one is NOT. And NOT is just reversing the outcome from given expression. In this case we have x equal to 15, so we should have false. By converting this false we get true, or we can use it directly in this way and we will get false. And NOT is just reversing the result of the variable. It's really important also to say that some numbers which are not equal to 0 will be considered as true. So if we try to get 42 and true, we will get true. But can you guess what is going to be the output from 0 and true? If you think that we have false, you're wrong, because we have 0. And as a bonus to this subchapter, I wanted to mention two links. The first is about Boolean algebra and the second one is truth table. I recommend for you to check them. And you can see here a table about AND and OR and also NOT operators and how they are working. You can check also the laws which are described in these articles, and you can see more operators which are covered in this article here and how they are working. Okay, so let's continue with conditional execution and why conditional execution is important in programming. Let's say that sometimes you have a condition and depending on this condition you need to execute something or not. For example, for positive numbers you need to execute one code and for negative another one. This can be achieved with using keyword if and this statement. We have if, condition, colon and then the execution flow. Okay, and can you guess for this second cell what is going to be the output? And if you guess that we'll have 1 and 4 are positive, then you're a good programmer. And now let's try to guess again what is going to be the output from 5 is greater than 0. If you think that will get true, you're wrong, because we cannot compare 5, which is stored as a string, to integer, and we get an error, which is type error, and you have some information about the problem, and we will check this at the end of the video. Sometimes you may need to get a condition and later do nothing in this condition. In this case, you can use a keyword pass, which is going to help you when you wait for some implementation or when you want to add some code later, just to put pass, do nothing, and add some command. In this case, you have to do and describing what needs to be done in future. And now let's say that we want to have two different alternative executions for one program. You can achieve this by using if and else. In this case, we have modulus operator. We're checking the remainder, is it equal to zero or not. And in this case, we can say is a given number even or odd. And for both cases, we can do something different depending on our case. Can you guess what is going to be the output from this program here? And if you ask yourself what is this and how this is working, this is a f-string or string interpolation, which was introduced recently in Python. And in this way, you can use f-string by putting f in the beginning of a string, then use curly brackets, providing a variable, in this case x, and print the result. And the variable is going to be replaced on this place here. And let's check the output. We have 1 is odd, minus 2 is even, and 4 is even. And this is how alternative executions are working. You have if, colon, and then you have else. And if the first condition is not met, everything is going to be executed in the second one. But if the first is true, then the program will run everything in the first condition. Sometimes you may need to change these conditionals. Let's check this example. We have a program where we need to compare two numbers and see if are they equal. Is one of them greater or less than another one? In this case, we can use elif, which is else if. And first we will check is x smaller than y, is x greater, and finally we will conclude that they are equal, because we don't have any other opportunity if we are trying to compare two numbers. But of course, you can have an error if one of the operands is not a number. And in this case, we can see that x is less than y, because we have 15 for x. There's no limit of how many elif you can use or how many statements you can have in one if. For example, here we can add another one. For example, with one, which is always considered as true, and you can add as many as you need for this case. The same is for elif clause. You can add as many you need for your program, but you need to be careful, because too many will make your program unreadable. And now I have a question for you. Can you guess what is going to be the output of this program? For example, are we going to have for x equal to 15 all of them printed, or only one of them printed, or none of them printed? So if you think that we are going to get all of them printed, this is not correct, because if one of these conditions is met, then only each statement is going to be executed. All the rest are skipped. And this is really important for you to be noticed how elif is working. So let's move on nested conditionals. Sometimes we may nest several if clauses. As you can see here, we are checking exactly the same for two numbers, are they equal or not. And this is done in the first statement. Then we have else clause, where we are checking is one of them greater or less than another one, and we're doing something different for those cases. Sometimes you can use nested conditionals, sometimes you can use chained conditionals, all depends on your needs, but I will recommend for you to try to make your program more readable and to add commands, and also to avoid nesting of many else and ifs clauses, otherwise you may make your program difficult for maintaining and also difficult for investigating problems of this program. And let's check how you can make your program a bit more easy to read by using operators and some other techniques. Let's say that we want to check these nested conditionals here. The first one is x greater than 0 and is x less than 10. If this is the case, we are going to print something. And then we can rewrite this by using a logical operator and putting the first two clauses on one and the same row, and we will get exactly the same result. But in this case, since we have only one variable in both statements, we can write it in this much more simpler way. And I recommend for you, if you're able to write all big and complex expressions as concise ones, do it and add some commands in order to make the life of your colleagues easier and also your life when you're trying to work with your programs in future. And now let's move on recursions, which is really important topic in programming and how recursion is working. In previous chapter, we saw what is a function and how the function is working and how we can call a function. So in Python, we are defining function with def, the name of the function and some parameters. For recursion, we will call a function inside this function. So we are defining functions countdown and we are calling the same function inside this function. But here you need to notice that we are reducing the input of this function by 1. And also that we need to have a stop condition, because if n is equal or less than 0, we are not calling anymore this function. And this is important in order to avoid infinite loops. And we'll check this in the next chapter. And let's try what we're going to have from this execution. Can you guess by looking on this code here and by calling this function for free, what is going to be the output? So you can see that we have if and else clause. We have a print, so we are printing the input, then we are calling the same function and we are decreasing the number with 1. So, sorry, we didn't define the function, but you can check also that for this kind of errors, we have countdown is not defined. We are trying to call this function, and this is how you can debug and check some of the problems with your programs. Let's try again. And we have 3, 2, 1, and then blast off. In this case, we're starting with 3, then we're decreasing, calling again the function, again we're decreasing, and finally when we reach 0, we print this string here, and this is how recursion is working. You can have several different levels of recursion. Also, you can pass many parameters or have some more advanced techniques for using recursion. In this case, we have printing function, which is going to print a string, which is the first argument. And the second one is how many times we are going to print it. And again, we have a stop for this function. If we reach 0, we are stopping the execution of the program. And let's check, we are printing s 2 times. And this is how recursion is working. You may check some more advanced topics from dynamic programming, how to optimize recursions and how to use, for example, memoization in order to make your programs better and to work more efficiently. You can check the stack diagrams from the book and how they are working. I will just briefly mention the picture here, and you can see that the same function is called several times with different arguments, and this might be really heavy for some programs if you try to calculate big numbers or if you try to calculate Fibonacci for huge numbers. That's why you need to optimize your programs and use something like memoization or something else. And can you guess what is going to be the output from this function? We have a function recurse. We are calling this function, but we don't have a stop statement. The stop statement is this one. And in the previous one, it was this one, which are stopping the invocation of the same function. But in this case, we don't have such stop statement. And let's check what is going to be the output from this program. We get maximum recursion depth exceeded and we have recursion error. If you don't have a good way how to stop your recursion, you'll get this error. And it's really important for you to be careful when you're dealing with recursions, because you can break your program. And also, if you put several levels of recursion one in another, this program might be difficult for debugging and also for investigation of some errors. That's why I recommend for you to be careful when you're using recursion and to use it when it's needed. Okay, so let's move on the next topic, which is keyboard input. Sometimes you will need to get the input from your user, and not as now, we were working only with predefined variables. In Python, you can use function input, which is going to get the input from the user. And let's check, we're going to use x. And now this variable x, if we try to use it, has this value x. And now we can prompt a string to the user what we want as input by providing this as parameter to input function. And again, we will have in this variable n a name, we will have the value x, and we can get different things by using this. For example, we can ask for a speed, we can ask what is the speed of a swallow, and then we can answer 100. And do you think that this is integer or string? If you think that this is integer, then you're wrong, because this is string. And if you try to do a comparison, you'll get an error. For example, value error or something else, depending on what you're trying to do and how do you try to use this. And finally, I want to go to debugging and say some words to this. Sometimes in Python you may face errors, and you have different type of errors. You have syntax error, as we saw earlier. We have semantic error and runtime error. Depending on an error, you will need to get what is the output. For example, if you try to run this expression here, can you see what is wrong with this expression? And if everything is okay, what is going to be the output? If you think that it's okay, this is not the case, because we have wrong indentation, and this is important in Python. You need to check where is the error. You can see that the error is for y, and we have unexpected indent. In this case, we need to remove it. But sometimes the output is not going to be so obvious and you will need to do some investigation. And this is where debugging is coming handy when you're trying to get what is wrong with your program and you need to investigate. In this case, nothing is problematic, but you need to check, for example, what are the values for X and Y if the program is not working correctly. As in this case, we get 100, but it's string. And if you're trying to do comparison to integer, you'll get an error. And sometimes these type of errors are visible only by doing debug of your program and trying to get the original source of the error. And here you can find another example of a problem. You can see that we have value error, mat domain error. In this case, you need to find where exactly is the problem. You need to investigate what is causing this problem and then see how to solve it. Finally, you can check the exercises and the glossary at the end of the chapter. And I recommend to you to extract some of the terms here and remember them, and also to do these exercises and share if you have any problems with them in the comment section below. Thank you for watching and see you next time.